So how do you now encode things?
This is Christophe Desimos, professor at University of Lausanne and at University College London. In previous video, we discussed DNA storage. However, we did not discuss how binary computer code is encoded in DNA. This turns out to be a nice and tricky problem.
I think one major difference between encoding information, artificial information, so arbitrary information, and the natural DNA is that in the natural form we have all of the information is encoded in long stretches in each chromosome, but that would be too expensive to store it in a very long molecule.
Why?
Because the synthesis, the way it works is a bit like a printer, an inkjet printer, where you have a matrix and you want to grow a little molecule, a little DNA molecule in each of the well, and you deposit just the right letter, you have, instead of having like four ink tanks in your printer, you've got like four tanks of DNA for the A, C, T, and G, and you have the right molecule that is deposited in the relevant wells, and then this gets then somehow incorporated. There's some reagents that will then induce the incorporation of that base, and then it can the cycle can restart. And so really, it's very similar technology.
Okay, so writing DNA basically boils down to gluing together consecutive letters on a DNA strand.
The thing is, if you make mistakes, though, then you have to get rid of the whole thing. And so you can imagine that as you want to have a longer and longer DNA strand, which is error-free, the costs are exploding.
So you do not want to write too long DNA strands, but too short DNA strands are not desirable either.
The trouble is, you had some very, very short molecules, say like, 10, 20 long oligonucleotides. That would be very useful for some application in molecular biology, but you could not store that much information. You might say, well, you could have loads of them, but then, how do you know in which order they go?
Yes, because DNA strands will not be nicely ordered in some tank. Rather, they'll be sort of floating in a packed volume of DNAs, and it will be extremely hard to pick one DNA strand over the others, especially if there are multiple identical DNA strands that correspond to different encoded parts of the binary code.
So you want something that is long enough, but you don't need something that is too long. And so actually, So when we stored the information, we were using about 150 base pair, which is incidentally also roughly, so this is something that could be synthesized at a, reasonable cost, and also that you can also read in one go. So that was a good length.
Okay, so now we have a huge number of DNA strands, each of which is made of 150 letters. But how do we read the data encoded in this large set of DNA strands? Before getting to reading synthetic DNA, it's useful to first wonder how we read natural DNA. Basically, it is possible to read sequences of 150 DNA letters. However, natural DNAs are longer than that, and we then need to find ways to recombine the read sequences in the right order.
We do then some assemblies, which is again a bit like a puzzle where you look for the part that overlap and you can put them together. But there are also some difficult parts like if you have some repeats, then there may be some ambiguities, like when you're trying to assemble the sky part of a puzzle, then you're no longer quite sure which part matches with which part. And so, so there are some tricks to try to overcome this, but actually we're quite hitting the wall with the technologies that can read only 150 base pairs. And for some species, it's actually quite difficult to do the sequencing.
However, for synthetic DNA, the puzzle is much easier to solve.
For synthetic DNA, though, we don't have this problem because we can cheat. We can add a little barcode that will tell in which position each piece of the puzzle is going to be. So it's not a very interesting puzzle to solve, but that's not the point, right? The point is to be able to reconstruct the entire sequence efficiently.
In other words, we can engineer the DNA encoding to optimize DNA reading.
So then, so you can see you need a bit of some piece for the address. In computer science, you would think of this as the address, and then you have some space for the information. And if you want to encode a lot of information, you may need to have longer addresses.
This is not so different from the way we use the web. Think about it. From your perspective, the web is just a huge mess of data. However, quite amazingly, you can access your favorite web page simply by entering the right so-called URL address. And that's because most web pages are associated with such an address. Similarly, the trick for DNA encoding is to use the first letters of the DNA strand to encode an address.
There's a trouble that you may think, okay, perhaps then you run out of space if all of your sequence is used for indexing. But, thanks to the logarithmic growth of your indexing scheme, and with 150 base pair, we can easily fit all of humanity's information. So this is kind of a non-problem. The efficiency decreases a little bit, but it's not much of a problem.
Let me just stress this logarithmic thing, as it is one of the coolest pieces of mathematics in computer science. The web today is huge. It is exabytes, if not zettabytes, of data. It seems quite impossible to retrieve any piece of data in this huge mess. However, this can be done using a URL address, which, weirdly enough, is vastly shorter than the size of the web. In fact, data on the web can be located using a URL address whose size is logarithmic in the size of the web. This means that if there are 10 to the 21 bits of data on the web, then the size of the URL address that you need will be typically roughly of 21 bits. And even if the amount of data gets multiplied by a million, then URL address will only need to be increased by a mere 6 bits, roughly. This amazing bit of mathematics explains why relatively short barcodes on DNAs can nevertheless allow for precise information retrieval.
That's right. And so there is maybe about 20 that I use for barcoding, and maybe there's a little checksum or a little bit of, you can think of this as the overheads, and then you have maybe 130 that is used for the actual information. I mean, there are different schemes that have been proposed, but this gives you an idea.
There's various problems we had to overcome. We can't make very long pieces of DNA as humans yet. So we had to invent a code that could make a message out of many short fragments of DNA.
I think the main challenge at the moment is cost, but I think the costs are going to go down, and I don't think we need a technological breakthrough.